Thank you. Well, good morning, friends.
Good morning.
It is always so good to be with those who are able to be in our sanctuary this morning. It's good to be joining with those who may be watching online either now or later on. This is one of those days when we understand a lot of folks are away with their family, and we've got folks that are here with their family. And so looking around, by chance, if there's any first-time guests, please do us a favor. After the services are out in the foyer, on my right and left, there's a little piece of paper that simply says, you're always welcome and wanted. We love to get your name and address so we can just send you a thank you note for being here. We love to give you a guest bag from our church. If by chance you're looking for a church home, you might have questions about Second, we would also be honored to answer any questions that you might have about our church. Well, I have to tell you that today is Mother's Day, and let me be the first to recognize that Mother's Day brings with it many different emotions for different folks, depending on what you have walked through in your journey or what you may be walking through in your journey, and we do understand that. Mother's Day takes us back to 1907. It was first observed in a place called Grafton, West Virginia. In thinking about the moms who may be with us, the moms who may be watching, we've got a couple of things we'd love for you to watch, so I direct your attention to the screen.
Of children who are still at home or all grown up. Moms who've outlived a son or daughter. Or moms of babies they never got to hold. Moms who've raised kids all on their own or became a mom to someone who needed one. Moms of children who have wandered from God or the longing to be moms who are still waiting. God perfectly arranged each of you into the role you have today. His word recognizes you as capable, strong, and praiseworthy. Everything you do makes our lives more beautiful. Happy Mother's Day.
When I climbed down to run and play as children all
powerful. If you have not been on our website or on Facebook, I was struggling over what to show. There's a one that's posted on our website that we posted yesterday, and I asked for it to be posted again this morning. I hadn't had time to check, but it's by the Heath brothers. It's very powerful. Three brothers, one set of twins. They're out in the field playing the piano. It's a powerful song. So if you haven't looked at it, please look up Second Baptist Church, Mount Holly. Play that, because that was another one I was debating about playing. When our service is over today, I think we've counted right. If not, I'll make it up to you. We will have a flower to give to every lady that is in this building right now. But for this particular moment, what I love to do, if you don't mind, is recognize those moms who are here. So if you can stand, moms, would you please stand so we can thank you this morning. Thank you for all that you do, men. Make sure to take them somewhere real nice today, especially Burger King or maybe a little higher. But this is a very special day. Father God, we love you. We thank you, Lord, for the beauty of this day and the gift of this day and the chance that is ours to join ourselves together with those who are in this sanctuary and maybe watching online. We are grateful, Lord, for the moms that have gone on before us, who made an example in our lives, grandmothers, whatever the case might be, for the moms that many of us are still privileged to have. We pray, Lord, that all the moms, all the ladies would know how very much they're loved by you and how much they're loved by us and how they're special, not just today, but every day. Lord, for this time that we're getting ready to enter into, as we'll sing songs together, as we'll study a particular lady in Scripture, we ask you, Lord, that you would take all that would be done in this place, and once again, that the Holy Spirit of God would take it, that you would use it. You know our needs. You know our desires. You know exactly where you need to minister to us right here and right now. And so, Lord, move in a very powerful way. If by chance there's someone here struggling in their relationship with you, they've gotten away from their relationship, whatever the need might be, Lord, may this be such a powerful day where souls are saved, lives are changed, decisions that are made that will forever change hearts, lives, marriages, families, and this, your church. It's in Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, if you can stand, would you please stand? Let's lift up our voices together this morning.
Stronger, the King of Lords. the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you will take my place, that you will bear my cross. Thank you.
hand.
Are you, Lord God Almighty? the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Oh, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry.
It's always a an honor and a privilege to sing for the Lord, but it's even more of an honor to sing on a special day like today. I'm a little bit nervous today. I'm gonna tell you, I had another song in my head, but this song's been on my heart for weeks now. And yesterday afternoon, I learned how to download something to my computer and burn my own CD. So I've only had this track less than 24 hours. So y'all please pray for me, but it's a beautiful song that was sung by Connie Hopper.
Stories of old from the Bible Mama told. Each day she talked about God, her friend. She told me about His love, about His home above. Sometimes I wish those stories would end. Then later one night, she had turned out the light in the darkness where no one could see. I heard a new sound. Mama turned it around. She was talking to God about me. Mama was praying for me, talking to God about me. With tears on her face, she's pleading my case. Mama was praying for me. Now that I'm grown, I have children of my own, and Mama, she's withered and gray. I found her in her chair, her eyes closed in prayer, unaware that I was visiting today. She whispered her name, and it didn't sound the same, so I leaned down much closer to hear. It thrilled me to find it was the children of mine. I know God heard my mama loud and clear. Mama was praying for me, talking to God about me. With a broken heart, she's taking my part. Mama was praying for me. Mama was praying for me. She was talking to God about me. Now I'll be alright, 'cause somewhere tonight, Mama will be praying for me.
Amen. Thank you, Anita. She has been called a great woman in God's eyes, a tremendous woman of faith, a great example for ladies, a great example for all. She has no name given to her. We only know her by the place that she was from. Would you please take a copy of God's Word? Go to the Old Testament, 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. Of course, for those of you who are coming, you realize, wait a minute, we've been in 1 Corinthians. Good Lord willing, we'll be back in 1 Corinthians. But as I shared earlier on Mother's Day, I always look for a lady in Scripture that I believe will make a difference to all of us on this particular day. Here's what we're going to talk about, an all is well faith. An all is well faith. 2 Kings chapter 4, beginning in verse 8. Now there came a day when Elijah, when you see the name Elijah, his name means God is my salvation. He was a prophet. He was a spokesman for God. Many of you will know that he had been mentored by Elijah, and now he has taken Elijah's place. So there came a day when Elijah passed over to Shunem. Shunem is a little village located near the Jezreel Valley, also known as the Valley of Megiddo, also known as the place where the Battle of Armageddon will one day take place. It's about 20 miles from Mount Carmel. And if you know anything about Mount Carmel, the first church I ever pastored was Mount Carmel Christian Church in Franklinton, North Carolina. But Mount Carmel takes me back to one of my favorite stories. I've always liked Westerns. I've always liked showdowns, and I've always bumped into people who say they love Gunsmoke. And I said, well, if you love Gunsmoke, you would know by now you don't mess with Matt Dillon. Well, you don't mess with Elijah, because if you remember anything about Mount Carmel, Elijah has taken on 450 false prophets of Baal. And the contest was whose God could call down fire from heaven. And we know, I just want to read this to you. I don't have anything to do. I just had it on my mind. The fire of the Lord fell, consumed the burnt offering, the wood, the stones, the dust, licked up the water that was in the trench. All the people saw it. They fell on their faces and they said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. Elijah said to them, seize the prophets of Baal. Do not let one of them escape. They seized them. They brought them down to the brook Kishon, and they slew all 450 false prophets. So this particular place, Shunem, was about 20 miles from the place called Mount Carmel. And it tells us that there came a day when Elijah passed over to Shunem, where there was a prominent woman. You'll have different translations. We believe prominent would mean a notable woman, a woman of wealth, a woman of influence, a woman of character. Well, she persuaded Elijah to eat food. And so it was, as often as he passed by, he turned in there to eat food. This lady is sharing of herself. She's sharing of her home. She is practicing the gift of hospitality. And she's going to offer some home cooking to this prophet. Now, I don't know where you come from. I don't know where you like to eat. But I'm telling you, friends, there ain't nothing like some good old home cooking. You can't buy this stuff at a drive-thru. You can't. I was sitting back there early this morning looking at pictures in the office, and I was reminded of both my grandmothers. And I'm telling you, if you had grandmothers, you know what I'm talking about. One of my grandmothers in particular, you'd show up at her house, and she'd say, well, I don't have a whole lot, but let me just put together something. Next thing you know, she's pulling out this and this and this. Next thing you know, we got 14 containers. Man, it's good stuff. Ain't nothing like some home cooking. And so she told Elijah, every time you're by, drop by, I'm going to feed you. And then here's what else happens. Look at verse 9. And she said to her husband, behold, now I perceive this is a holy man. She had great discernment. She had great wisdom. She had godly wisdom. And she knew there was something different about this man of God. She said, I am aware, I perceive this man is a holy man. What a great compliment. Set apart, separated, he's different in character. He's different in everything that he's about. So I want to ask you a couple of questions this morning. Here's the first question. Can that be said about you and I on Mother's Day? For those in the sanctuary, for those who are watching. Can it be said, you know, there's something different about him? You know, there's something different about her. You know, there's something different about them and the way they act and the way they talk and the things they do. There's just something different about them. She perceived that this man was a holy man of God. It's a great example, so many great principles in today's scripture. One of our challenges this morning is that we are consistent in our lifestyle, that when folks watch us, be it either Sunday, Saturday, Monday, it don't matter. We're consistent in our lifestyle. We practice what we preach. We are who we say we are. We are whose we say we are. That in everything that we do, we represent the Lord Jesus Christ so that folks will see Christ in us, but it not be about us, but that he will receive all the glory and all the honor. So this man of God is going to be invited to her house because she knew there was something different about him. And then she makes a request to her husband. Look at verse 10. She said to her husband, "Please let us make a little walled upper chamber and let us set a bed for him there and a table and a chair and a lampstand. And it shall be when he comes to us that he can turn in there." "Hey, honey, would you mind if we build this man of God a room on our roof?" Which was very common in this day. They're going to put a room on the roof, and you'll see it right out of Scripture. In that room, a bed, a table, a chair, and a lampstand. So as Elijah was traveling through this area, he would have a home away from home, if you will. He would have a place to rest. He would have a place to stay. This is what we know of as a quote-unquote prophet's chamber. And so they were going to build a prophet's chamber for the man of God. Because keep in mind, unlike today, there are no verbos. There were no hotels, no motels, none of that stuff. You relied on the hospitality of others. A lot of folks slept outside. But you relied on the hospitality of others. And so what a blessing this would be that every time he passed by, not only would he get some good home cooking, but he would also have a home away from home. So with that in mind, look at verse 11. "One day he," Elijah, "came there." Of course, he's talking about the home of this man and this woman. "And he turned into the upper chamber and rested." Verse 12 said, "He said to Gehazi, his servant," his personal attendant, "call this Shunammite." Ah, so right there we know what this lady was referred to. You'll never see her name. We simply know her as the Shunammite woman, based on that scripture. So he said, "Call this Shunammite." And when he called her, she stood before him. He said to him, Elijah is talking to his personal attendant, "Say now to her, 'Behold, you've been careful for us with all this care. What can I do for you?'" Elijah was very grateful. He was very thankful for her hospitality, for the kindness of not only her, but her husband. But he's focusing on her, thinking about her kindness, thinking about her concern, thinking about her care. He wants to do something for her. So the question is, what can I do for you? How can I help you? How can I return your kindness? Now, I won't ask you to answer this out loud. But if somebody was to come to you this day, and they would say your name, fill in your name, blank. "You know, I've been thinking about you, and I just want to do something for you. So here's a blank piece of paper. Here's a blank check. You fill it in. Whatever you say, I'll do." How would you fill in the blank? How would you fill in the check? The answer that immediately came to our heart shows the priorities of our life. The answer that came immediately to your life, your mind, shows the priority of your life. He says, "What can I do for you? How can I help you? How can I return the favor for you?" Then he says something fascinating that you wouldn't know if you didn't go back and look at all the stuff that's going on in that area. He says, second part of verse 13, "Would you be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the army?" Elijah had some influence, even in the midst of a terrible, ungodly administration. And so he says, "What can I do for you? Is it somebody I can put a good word in for you?" And I'm amazed at the way she answers the question. Look what she says, the last part of verse 13. Here was the Shunammite woman's answer to "What can I do for you? How can I return your kindness?" She answered, "I live among my own people." If you would just read that translation, "What in the world does that mean?" But if you look at maybe other things that you're looking at right now in your Bibles, in your study Bibles, it could easily be translated like this. What can I do for you, ma'am? She would respond, I'm fine. I'm good. It's okay. I'm content. Thank you anyway. I read that response, and I immediately just stopped what I was doing. Because lots of times before you get anything, I have to deal with all of this and be honest also before a holy God who knows everything about all of us. And I asked myself the question when I read her response in verse 13 that I'm going to ask you right now. Can it be said about us that we're content? That we're satisfied in the things that we have? I don't have to tell you what happened this week. I was here and ran over to be with our daycare kids. I had family on mattresses in the house. I had a son in the basement with 340 students and all the staff. We're watching everything that you saw. And I don't say this because I ain't nobody, but people call. In fact, my daughter called and said, Dad, you all right? I said, God is in control. If he don't have this, we're all in a mess. I said, y'all be safe. Talk to you in a little while. I'm heading over to the childcare. And when I watched all that happen, and unfortunately, it affected some of the people who are here. But more important than trees in our yard, that we know of people who unfortunately died in their vehicles when a tree hit them. And we know of people who lost their homes. We know of people who are just not in the situation we are this morning. Maybe we had to pick up a few limbs, cut a tree, those kind of things. Can we ever be content? Can we ever be satisfied with what we have? This lady had a blank page, if you will. And she says, I'm good. I'm good. Well, Elijah's not satisfied. He wanted to do something for this lady. So look at verse 14. He is talking to his personal attendant, Gehazi. He asked a question. What then is to be done for her? And Gehazi answered, truly she has no son and her husband is old. Now she's asked for nothing. She's saying she's content. In these days, unlike today, things have changed. Again, realizing on this Mother's Day, being very careful and praying about everything I would like to say. There are folks who have wanted, I know many people, maybe you do, who've done everything they can to have children. And regardless of the doctors and the shots, they never could have kids. And I know of many who became foster parents and they've been blessed. And I know of many who've adopted and they've been blessed. And the story is different for everybody, and I understand that. Like I said, today people are getting married later. They're having kids later. Things are not like they were in the Bible. In the Bible days, people who didn't have a kid or a son to carry on the name of daddy, I don't know why it would be like that. They would be looked at as they had been cursed by God. They would be looked at as something that happened to them, and it was a sign of shame. And that's not always the case. I guess what I want to say to you free of charge right now is let's back off some of these young couples that maybe don't have kids. Because maybe they can't have kids. And sometimes we put a little pain on them and pressure. Let's just be very sensitive, especially on this day of those who are struggling because they didn't have a good mama. Or those who don't get along with mama right now. We take so much for granted. She says, I'm good. But the personal attendant said, she don't have a kid. She don't have anybody to carry on daddy's name. So watch what happens. Look at verse 15. Elijah said to his servant, call her. When he called her, she stood in the doorway. Then he said, at this season next year, you will embrace a son. Rogers translation. I know you said you didn't want anything, but guess what, sister? Next year, you're going to have a baby boy. I don't know what that would do for you right now. I know what it would do for me. Oh, no. Elizabeth, I'm coming to join you, honey. Because I'm 60 years of age. No. All right, well, watch this. Watch this. Second part of verse 16. And she said, "No, my Lord, O man of God, do not lie to your maid servant." Can I translate? Don't get my hopes up. Don't play games with me. Don't be kidding around about something like this. Please don't lie to me. That is too good to be true. I am way too old, and my husband's way too old. No way, no how. But you do know, don't you? Is there anything too hard for our God? You remember, don't you? How old was Abraham and Sarah when Isaac come along? My brother was 100. My sister was 90. And here come Isaac. Hey, I know you didn't ask for anything, but next year you're going to have a boy. Oh, come on, come on. Watch what happens. We're talking about a supernatural birth. 17, the woman conceived and bore a son at that season the next year, just as Eliza had said. So I know, and I don't have the time I like to develop this. But wait a minute, Roger. Why do things happen like that to some people, and they don't happen like that to all people? That's a great question. I don't have all the easy answers. I don't have all the quick fixes. If I did, I would give them to you right now. I can't answer all that. There are things, here's my go-to verse. Most of the church knows this, but for those who might be guests or watching, my go-to verse is Deuteronomy 29:29. Deuteronomy 29:29. I invite you to look it up later on, start, circle it. Basically, it says this: there are a lot of things we'll never understand, but we're responsible for the things that we do understand. So I don't know. In this particular case, God moved in a supernatural way. And I don't know why he doesn't always do that. I don't know. I know he's God, and I know I've learned to trust him as you have when things are good and when things are tough. In this particular situation, he moved upon her life. So then we go to verse 18. When we come to verse 18, I have no idea how old he was. For all of us, it's different. When we began to work, I was told that they put me in the tobacco fields when I was 5. So I don't know when you started going to work. But verse 18 said that when the child was grown, so he's at the right age to go to work, because the day came that he went out to his father, to the reapers. So he's old enough to go with daddy to work. But then he starts having major head problems. Verse 19 tells us, he said to his father, "My head, my head." He said to his servants, "Carry him to his mother." Verse 20. When he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her lap until noon, and then he died. I stood with a family yesterday. The young man started feeling bad in March. In 2 months, he had lost 100 pounds. He died of pancreatic cancer. It spread all over his body. They were trying to track me down to do the service. His daddy, I won't go where he lives, but he lived away from here. He and I tried to go back and forth with 22 phone calls because I really wanted to talk to his daddy and see what I could do to talk to his daddy. Because I'm telling you, y'all, I never met this family till yesterday. But I cannot imagine. And if you're here and you lost a kid, I don't even know what to say to you. I know what it means to lose grandparents. I was involved in pretty much all their funerals. I know what it means to lose a daddy. I did his funeral. I know what it means to stand with families who, from stillborn to 102 years of age, because I've had them, stillborn, 7-day-old, 3-year-old, 5-year-old, I've had them. And at those moments, I'm telling you, y'all, I feel like I've lost a child because I've been blessed. Ours are healthy, 31, 28, and 25. I have a healthy 2-year-old grandbaby. I can't imagine. I don't know how she feel, how she would feel. I don't know how you would feel. So if you've been through that, I don't know what to say to you, because nobody expects to lose their child before the Lord calls us. But here we are introduced to the tragedy and the reality of death. But here's what catches my attention about this lady. Jews usually buried their loved ones on the same day. That is not what Mama is going to do. Look at 21. She went up. You got the picture. She's got this boy. Again, I don't know how old he is. I'm going to assume he's young. She went up and she laid him on the bed of the man of God. And she shut the door behind him and she went out. So again, when I have a chance to preach and teach the word of God, I try not to preach and teach what we don't have and what I don't know. But based on what we just read and what you can read as good as I can, we don't see any panic. We don't see any crying. We don't see any mourning. We don't see any fear. We simply see a mother with an all is well faith, as we'll talk about in just a minute. And she simply takes her son and lays her son on Eliza's bed. And I thought about this. You've heard this. When we can't trace God's hand, we can what? Trust his heart. So watch what happens. She called her husband. And she said, please send me one of the servants, one of the donkeys, that I may run to the man of God and return. He said, why would you go to him today? It's neither new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it will be well. Now, again, reading what we have. Reading what we have. I invite you, please, always bring the word of God. Always make sure that I'm reading and teaching what you have in front of you. And I always make sure to follow up so that I will not teach anything that's error and untruth in this church. What we have in front of us is this. She did not share with her husband what had happened. And he did not ask anything about the boy from what we have. Again, I can't answer all those questions about why didn't he ask anything. I know why she didn't say anything, because it's going to unfold as we keep on. She wants to get to the person that to her represented God, and that was Prophet Elisha. Guess what? Guess what? There are people who look at you, and to you, you are the only representative of God they will ever see. So that's why people watch us. That's why they listen to what we say. They watch what we do, because we might be the only God they ever see. So she's got to get to this man who in her mind represents God. So she saddled the donkey, verse 24. She saddled the donkey. She said to her servant, drive, go forward. Do not slow down the pace for me unless I tell you. So she went and came to the man of God, to Mount Carmel. When the man of God saw her at a distance, he said to Gehazi, behold, there is a Shunammite. Please run now to meet her and say to her, look at these three questions. First of all, is it well with you? You okay? Second of all, is it well with your husband? Your husband okay? Third of all, is it well with your child? Is the boy okay? Now watch this. What'd she say? You got your Bibles open. What'd she say? It is well. It is well. Is that what you would have said? Again, based on what we have right here in front of us, she didn't say anything to Eliza's personal attendants, because she didn't want to talk to the personal attendant. She wanted to talk to the person that represented God. She wanted to get to Eliza. This is where I see an all is well faith. An all is well faith, where you don't understand everything and you don't like everything and you can't explain everything and everything doesn't make sense. And yet you realize that God's always up to something. Maybe you've been there. And I hope that you know this verse. If I simply say 8:28, I hope you know what I mean if I say 8:28. If you don't know what I mean when I say 8:28, jot this verse down, look it up, circle and start. Romans 8:28 says this. This is a something the child of God can claim right now. And we know that all things, now listen what it says, all things work together for the good. Not that everything makes sense. Not that everything seems to be good. Not that I don't like this. All things work together for the good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. She wanted to get to the man of God. So she simply says, it is well. Hang with me. 27. She came to the man of God, to the hill. She caught hold of his feet. Why is she holding on his feet? Submission, humility, reverence, respect. Gehazi came near to push her away. But the man of God said, let her alone. Her soul is troubled within her, and the Lord has hidden it from me, and he's not told me. Something was bothering her. He didn't know what it was, but he's getting ready to find out. 28. She said, did I ask for a son from my Lord? Did I not say, do not deceive me? Automatically, right then, Eliza, the man of God, knows something's wrong with her son. And I would argue with you, based on my understanding of the scripture, she knew right then, the son is dead. So watch what happens. 29. He said to Gehazi, gird up your loins, take my staff. The staff was a symbol of God. It was a symbol of his presence, a symbol of his power. It was a symbol of Eliza's authority under God. Take my staff in your hand. Go your way. If you meet any man, do not salute him. If anyone salutes you, do not answer him. Lay my staff on the lad's face. Go. Go as quick as possible. And put the staff down on the little boy's face. The mother of the lad, verse 30 said, as the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So he arose and followed her. So he sent, Gehazi said, the mama said, no, you're going with me. So there goes mom. Here comes Eliza. 31. Then Gehazi passed on before them, laid the staff on the lad's face, but there was no sound or response. So he returned to meet him and told him, the lad has not awakened. Eliza came into the room. Behold, the lad was dead, laid on his bed. So he entered, shut the door behind them both, and he prayed to the Lord. Now keep in mind, this is a man of God who's a spokesman for God, but the first thing he does is he prays to God. Why? To recognize his total dependence upon God for everything that's getting ready to happen. I hope and pray that we understand, whether we have a lot, whether we have a little, whatever we have, to always thank God for the way that he blesses us, for the way that he takes care of us. So he shut the door and he's praying. Verse 34. This is a powerful, powerful picture. He went up and look at this. Look at it, y'all. You try to get this in your mind. You can see this. He lay on the child. He put his mouth on the boy's mouth. He put his eyes on the boy's eyes. He put his hands on the boy's hands. You got it in your mind? He's right there on top of this kid. And he stretched himself on him, and the flesh of the child became warm. Again, Roger, I don't understand. Why didn't that happen in my circumstance? I don't know. In this circumstance, not only have we had a supernatural birth, but now we got a supernatural healing. 35. He returned, he walked into the house once back and forth, went up and stretched himself on him, and the lad sneezed 7 times. I looked everywhere in the world. Maybe you got it in your Bible. I couldn't find it. Why 7 times? Only thing came to my mind is when you think of 6 is the best man can do. But when you think of 7, you know that when you add God to the equation, you got perfection, you got completion. That's all I know. I don't know. He sneezed 7 times, and the lad opened his eyes. Verse 36, he called Gehazi and he said, call the Shunammite. So he called her. When she came into him, he said, take up your son. Now, ladies, hey, let's be honest. Before you read the last verse, don't look ahead. Before you read the last verse, somebody says, hey, something has changed. When you walk in there, first thing you want to do is grab that boy. That ain't what she does. Watch this. 37, she went in, fell at his feet, Eliza, and bowed herself to the ground. The first thing she did. It wasn't anything about Eliza, but to her, Eliza represented God. So she is bowed down in an attitude of gratefulness and thankfulness for what has happened. And then it says, she took up her son and went out. And I read that and I thought, you know what? Lord, have mercy, please forgive me. How quick are we to complain about everything, and how slow are we to give God praise and to give God thanks? What an example this lady showed me in many, many different things. So, if you're like me, you read the story and say, okay, Roger, what happened to the boy? I wish I could tell you. I have no idea. So why are we doing this, Roger? Because I don't know his story. What about yours? And what about yours who are watching? What about your story? What about your testimony? What are you going to do with the gift of this day? What are you going to do with the gift of life? What are you going to do with the gift of your family? What are you going to do? Do we have an all is well faith? Does he have an all is well faith? Do we have an all is well faith where we can trust God in and through everything? Will we use our lives to seek to be a blessing to other folks? To make a difference in other folks? To make it matter that we were here in the first place? This lady, I had never studied before. I read about her, but I never studied. I thought, wow, ma'am, you have set so many examples for us on this day. Not just ladies, but all of us. So here's my challenge, Mom, Dad, kids, individuals. How's your faith? How's your faith? When we don't like what's going on, we can't explain what's going on. It don't make any sense, and we want to get angry. Think about the Shunammite woman who had an all-is-well faith. Well, guess what? We'll never have faith until we have a relationship. Everything starts with relationship. So by chance, if you're here this morning and you never place your faith and trust in Christ and Christ alone, if you're watching, you can contact us. Love to talk to you, love to pray with you. But if you're here, we invite you to come and say, Roger, there's a lot of things I don't understand, but I know something's been missing in my life. I would like to place my faith and trust in Christ. Greatest decision you'll ever make. Most important thing you'll ever do. You say, well, Roger, I've trusted the Lord. I've just never told anybody. Man, don't be ashamed. Don't be embarrassed to take your stand for the Lord. You come. We want to celebrate with you, see what God's got in store for you. Maybe you're here and you're like, Lord, I know this is where I'm supposed to worship. I need to be a part of this church. We would be so honored to work with you and worship with you. You just simply come and say, I want to be a part of Second. And then maybe there's somebody you want to be praying about today. Maybe there's some folks you're going to see in just a little while as you have get together and you're just concerned and you want to pray. This is the most important time of this entire day. So let's take advantage of it. Father God, as always, thank you for your word and the power of your word and the power of the Spirit of God. Lord, right now as we come to this time, would you move in this sanctuary? Would you do what only you can do in our hearts and our lives for your honor, for your glory? In Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you please stand? Be faithful and obedient to the Spirit of God.
As always, we want to thank you for taking the time to join with us and as folks are making decisions in our sanctuary. Just wanted to talk to you. And maybe you're out there this morning and you've been watching. The Lord's been dealing with you. Perhaps you need to place your faith and trust in the Lord. It's very simple. Lord, I want to say, perhaps you're out there and you're trusting the Lord. Of course, everything's a little bit different right now. You just never told him about it. And the first chance you tell somebody, don't ever be ashamed. Don't ever be embarrassed to take your stand for the Lord Jesus Christ. And as soon as you get a chance to go to a local church, everybody lives in a local church. Live in this area, live close by. We would be honored to have you right here in Second Baptist in the hall. We'd love to work with you.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul.
He's who I talk to.
But I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake.
Roger, SBC, I'm excited.
challenge.